next presenter is Luciano Pietronero, who is a professor of physics at the Sapienza University of Rome and the founder and director of the Institute for Complex Systems. He's well known for a multitude of contributions in statistical physics. Lately, he got the new line of fame in his exploration in economic complexity, which gets a lot of attention. Please welcome Luciano Pietronero.
Thank you, guys. It's always a great pleasure to come here, and I wish you all the best. So let me tell you, a lot of things I heard, I agree totally, I will mention briefly, but let me tell you one thing that makes me uncomfortable about the community of complexity, and which may help to measure the progress. You see, I worked in many fields, for example, superconductivity, and the superconductivity, the standard one, was discovered in 1911, was understood in 1957, the standard, the BCS. In the meantime, Feynman did the wrong theory, Heisenberg did the wrong theory, Felix Bloch did the wrong theory, many others like this did the wrong theory. And finally, Bardeen and company did the right theory. In complexity, nobody does the wrong theory. This is a problem. Seriously. Because, you know, then you have no distinction. I mean, it's clear what I mean, okay? So if you ask a sharp question, you can say this is right, this is wrong. If you don't ask a sharp question, okay, creativity, very nice, I also agree with that. But one day, to have impact, we have to ask sharp questions. So I want to propose a prize for the first of us who does a theory which we all agree is wrong, okay? And for this, I candidate for Ig Nobel Prize, okay? Because I am an admirer of Andrea Rapisarda, after all. Okay, having said this, which is not as much a joke as it may seem, I tell you a little bit of the story of this field, but not in the standard perspective, in a totally different perspective. Many people say it's important to have an impact. How do we have an impact? Maria Mitrovic said we should tell something the World Bank. Others say, you know, let's focus on problems rather than on techniques, I mean, like Janos and others. So this story had an impact. Not always happened to me. I mean, some other cases I had not much impact. So this method developed in the last 5 years is now fully accepted by World Bank in the past 2 years. And they came to Rome, actually, without a contract from us. They read the paper, so it's very interesting. You know, it's good to read not in Nature, not in Science, normal papers. They read these papers, came to us, and somehow started a collaboration. Now this methodology has been used in the World Bank in the past 2 years for the analysis of over 50 countries and also for private sector analysis. So one can say it went into mainstream economic institutions. So I want to share with you what is my feeling, why this worked, so to say, and other things didn't. Just this is a few comments on this. First, how this arises, I agree with all the people that said you need, you know, blue sky, you need to waste your time into things which are not immediately applicable. Right. I established it in 2004, the Italian Institute of Complex Systems, and I ran it for 10 years or maybe even more. And so there is clearly a strategic vision in going into complexity from me and from many others who participated. On the other hand, the second part was serendipitous. I had, you know, a paper in the train in my bag, and once I was tired in the train, I didn't want to work, so after many months having this paper, I read it. And then I got the idea, maybe I can do better, and then we did better, and then it developed in many ways. So, there is, you know, combination of strategy and causal situation. But what is the first point? The first point is to focus on a problem which is clear. You know, here is what defines economic growth. I can be more clear in the next slide than this, but this is clear enough. You know, in 20 years, this is the development of Shanghai. For example, if you consider that Brazil was not any worse than China in 1990, and of course it didn't have at all this development in the following 20 years. So the growth of China is a very sharp scientific problem. You can put it into quantitative terms. This is the growth of GDP of China from 1980 to now. Somebody talked about the world financial crisis. Which crisis? You see, 2007, 2008, China grew 10%. the crisis is Eurocentric. So we shouldn't make this mistake, you know, to think that we are the world. We are important, we US. China is 1.5 billion people. They didn't know about the crisis, for example. And we would like to understand why they grew so much. On the right, I've put a few of the leading opinionists. I mean, I can add twice as many. These are collected by this journalist, Godfrey Roberts. He has a whole website. I just put a few because they don't fit the same as the one slide. As you see, the analysis starts in 1990. In 1990, China seemed to go down. And this was the origin of the first economist piece, because the statistics of fast-growing countries, fast means more than 5%, is that on average it lasts 10 years plus or minus 2. So in 1990, what was the argument based on statistical recurrence or whatever, or inspection? That China had grown for 10 years and now it was finished. Okay, and you see there, the economy is 1990. Then it continues to grow. So what do? You say, I'm wrong? Or you say, God damn it, now it really has to collapse, okay? Like when you miss a number in the lotto. That was the argument. So every year they say, really, now has to go down, God damn it. Okay, even now they say China beats again, where the 2017 is growing 6.9%. So this, I think, is a sharp problem, okay? If you study growth and you don't understand China, then you better forget. Okay, so we want to focus on something clear and important, okay? This was our ambition. Now, what do these people do? These people collect big data. These people of the opinions on the right collect big data, they put the most big data together. So how do we improve? We make more big data, twice as many big data? Well, this was our first opinion and originality, where complexity helps. So, if you have more data, are you sure you do better? Okay, this was the first question. Well, what does it mean? You can say a la Poincaré, if you enlarge the space of your dynamical recurrence, then the information grows exponentially, the needed information is exponentially with the dimension of the space. But you can say in a more down-to-earth, when we went to elementary school, our teacher told us you cannot add apple and bananas, okay, because this is wrong. It's the same story as Poincaré, said in a more plain way. What does it mean, this story? That if you want to predict the GDP, GDP is one number, and when in this number you want to put education and pollution, for example, you are adding apple and banana. Technically, this means that you have more information, but you have also more noise. And I think Andrea Rapisarda made precisely this point, right? Okay, I agree totally. So, you see, this is the problem. Economists, they don't know this, really. I mean, but usually it doesn't help to go and tell them, look, guys, we are very, very smart, and you are idiots, so you have to realize how useful we can be for you. I think this does not work. You have to prove you can do something better with a little bit of arrogance, namely that you are knowledgeable a little more, but with the humility that you have to accept that the others will judge you. So we accept that the World Bank judges you, not my friends in here, that we are all specialists to solve all sorts of problems, okay? So, okay, this is the thing. So we try to go into this story. And then what did we do? We said, okay, let's do the opposite. We want to do zero noise. That means eliminate data, minimum data. So basically, we want to go from 100 parameters, 100, 200, how many, to zero. Of course, this is another space, I mean, another criterion, and we don't throw away the data. We use them hierarchically. But for example, to define the economic fitness, we only use the data on products, or if you want, on labor. So we use only one. So we go to a totally different story. And then you can add the technological fitness or you can add the scientific fitness. But we don't make a big soup with all together to find one number, okay? This is the different strategy. This has two strategic advantages. The first is that the main criticism, one of the main criticisms of the Washington Consensus guys, of which the World Bank is one of these cathedrals, one of the main criticisms is, if you have 100 parameters and the government is going to make a policy, industrial policy, which they oppose because the market should be the master, then no matter what, this government will do what is politically favorable to them. So this is the main objection of the Washington consensus. So if you eliminate the parameters, this objection is eliminated. So this helps you a lot to talk to Washington consensus environments. The second thing is that if you take our papers and you spend a few months, I mean, you repeat the same result and you get the same result. This is often not the case. If you try to repeat what the International Monetary Fund forecasting, is impossible. But also most of the economist paper is impossible to reproduce. So we introduce two elements, one reproducibility and zero parameters. The price we pay, we have less data. Then, okay, we invent a new algorithm. This is supposed to be the analogous of Google. Okay, but I don't want to discuss the algorithm. This has been discussed with the World Bank, etc. But what I want to say is what is the moral, in my opinion, of this story. So for each new big data problem, there will be an algorithm, as there is a theory, or for each physical phenomenon. There may be more general theories. But this means that big data is not just a matter of data crunching, but is a creative, beautiful field in which you have to invent a story. And the story starts with selecting the right data, which needs a little bit of art also, or intuition, then inventing some type of algorithm that, in this case, is different from Google. So it means there is life after Google, as I like to talk, and so on. So this is the message I get from what our experience. So for the future in other fields, I think I would try this approach. Then this leads to a totally different story for predictability, where you have a flow in a two-dimensional space that we have introduced, so the space of income fitness, which is totally different than the economists, and they do mostly regression, so we don't do anything like that. And out of this, we challenged the IMF on their own ground. Who does better forecasting? This is a lot of work. I mean, not a genius, but it needs to be careful and to be accurate. And what happened was that our forecasting are better than the official IMF. So this made the Bloomberg View to write a statement which for us was very gratifying. New research has demonstrated that the fitness technique systematically outperforms standard methods despite requiring much less data. This was written after the World Bank showed interest, but certainly this has attracted a lot of attention. So I think this is an example. I've done other things, for example, I've done work on agent models and nobody cared, so it's not anything. It was a lucky coincidence. But as you can see a pattern. The pattern is address a clear problem, important, try to challenge the field on the people on their ground and accept their own evaluation and so on. And this may give you a higher chance that they take you seriously. Then you can go, of course, this is somehow years ago. Then you can go in detail, you do the product space and so on, but this is not so important. I mean, you can go on along the same line and have a lot of information on details of growth of specific products for specific countries or companies and so on. So this is what we are doing in the last years. More in closing, I want to draw a conclusion out of this. For example, is it true that basic science, technology, and innovation is the key of economic development? Well, from what we studied, the thing is not so obvious. Because, for example, if you look at Chile and South Korea in the 60s, they were similar in science and innovation. Actually, Chile was even better. But today, Chile didn't develop much, and South Korea became among the few industrial countries in the world. So what is the social, socio-political moral of this story? That there is no magic formula for development. You need a comprehensive structure, and we believe this story can help to put a scientific basis to this thing. Last, I want to list what are the new specific elements we can address to complexity with respect to the standard. As you see, there are many. So complexity is not one formula, it's not the Schrödinger equation. Somebody said it's a state of mind. So it's addressing things with an original view. The original view can be right and can be wrong. And I think it is important that somebody does it wrong so that we can also understand when it is right. Thank you very much.